Okay, good evening, everybody. Welcome. Okay, I think we are. I've got my audio here. Thanks for the awesome processional tonight. So I had a military escort in through Bree from the South Gate all the way to the Lore Hall here by the courtesy of the Sons of Numenor kinship. Thank you, guys. They're all looking very dapper in their black and white uniforms here this evening. Thanks very much. So, and good evening, everybody. Welcome back. Very glad to return here after a week off. I was on vacation with my family last week, and I am super glad that I did not attempt to do a broadcast because my internet was just awful where I was. So it was definitely for the best that we didn't attempt that. So tonight we are returning, and indeed we are going to complete Chapter 2 and rashly move on to Chapter 3. That is the humble goal for the evening here this evening. Let's get to it here. I'm almost like forgetting how to make. I want to make sure I'm remembering how to do everything, and I've got everything working correctly. I think I have all my correct windows open, so that's good. Don't forget, those of you who are still relatively new, if you want to participate, if you want to get text chat to me, I can see chat in the Twitch channel, but I can't promise to follow it all the time. We have a text channel in our Discord channel, the link to which should be posted there on Twitch. You should be able to get into the text channel called Lore Hall Questions for Corey, and I will be able to get that and follow along with you as we go. So, all right. And Druid's Fire, the barbecue in Texas was awesome. That was great. I went to Dallas, Fort Worth for the first time. Spent most of my time in Fort Worth, actually, last weekend, which is why I wasn't able to do the Griffith stream before last. My first trip to, second time I've ever been to Texas. First time in a long time. It was great. So, okay. Yeah, so Galandar says, at one chapter a month, we'll be ready for the appendices in 2022. Possibly. We'll see. I'm not sure if we'll end up going quite that fast, but we'll end up seeing. But yeah, no, I've decided that I am not going to be in a hurry. I see. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. You'll notice I came back from the north with the beginnings of a little beard here. I've been married for almost 20 years. Our 20th anniversary is later this year. And my wife, for the first time ever, gave me permission to grow a beard. So I was like, okay, all right, I'll try to grow a beard. So there we are. All right, let us get started. Now, tonight, since we missed last week, we had 2 weeks of contributions to our discussion board. I wanted to make sure to remind you of that. If you go to lotro.mythgard.org to the discussion boards there, you will see the questions for Narnian section where you can get questions, and we will begin to go through some of these. So I have a backlog to go through there, so we'll start in on those here right away. Tonight's class I'm calling Plots and Plans, as we begin to look at both the plot that is underway among the hobbits and the plans that Gandalf and Frodo make at the beginning of Chapter 3. Grim was asking, why is my name Narnian? Actually, so that is Sindarin. It sounds more Lewis than Tolkien. It's a total coincidence. The similarity between the name Narnian and, of course, the Land of Narnia from the Chronicles of Narnia, much as I love C.S. Lewis and the Chronicles of Narnia, total coincidence. Narnian in Sindarin, it's from the word meaning story. So like a rough translation of Narnian from Sindarin into English would be like the story guy, basically. That's why he is named that. Niarion, N-Y-A-R-I-O-N, is the Quenya version of the same. So on some servers, I'm Narnian, and others I'm Niarion, depending on whether Narnian was available or not. So that's it. So that's where, so the story guy, that's basically what his name means. Good question. Good question. Okay. So, let's look at a few, contributions. We've got several contributions from some of our steadiest contributors. Always appreciate hearing from you. Lincoln Alpern had some reflections on, Frodo and Gandalf's conversation here. So, "I wish it need not have happened in my time," said Frodo. "So do I," said Gandalf, "and so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given to us." So here's the... So this is Lincoln's question about that passage. "The syntax in this passage is very tricky to follow. I always read Gandalf's 'so do I' to mean 'I wish it had not happened in my time either,' in part because I find it more powerful, and in part because of the next part, 'and so do all who live to see such times.' The problem, of course, is that from a Silmarillion perspective, Gandalf talking about how he feels here would be nonsensical, because one, as an immortal himself, all of time is his time, and two, he and the other wizards were sent to Middle-earth specifically to combat the shadow whenever it rears its ugly head." So, right, the odds of Gandalf happening to live during a peaceful period of time in which the shadow would not arise is really not on the cards, right? I mean, if Gandalf is like, "Oh yeah, man, I wish I could get out of this too," you're right, that doesn't seem like it would make much sense, right? "The interpretation that Gandalf is talking about Frodo is more plausible than I originally thought. That is, that he's not saying... Gandalf's not saying, 'Oh yeah, I wish it didn't happen in my time either,' but rather Gandalf is saying, 'I also wish it need not have happened in your time,' right? That would be the alternative interpretation of the syntax there. Anyway, because in the next sentence he says, 'That is not for them to decide,' suggesting that he may not include himself when he refers to all people who live to see such times. Maybe I'm grasping at straws here, trying to defend my preferred interpretation, but I still find the syntax of Frodo's exclamation and Gandalf's initial response difficult to reconcile with the 'Gandalf is just talking about Frodo here' scenario." And Lincoln, I completely agree with you. It does sound like he's agreeing with the sentiment, right? Not just, "I think the same thing about you," but rather, "I feel the same way you do." That does, it's very hard, I agree, not to hear "so do I" in that way. But, as Lincoln says, that leaves us with a discrepancy between this version of Gandalf and his backstory as stated in the Silmarillion. Great question. Glad you brought that up. I don't think so, though. Here are my thoughts about that. The main thing I would say, based on all the information that we have, the incarnation of the wizards is more complete than I think you're giving it credit for. On the one hand, yes, Gandalf is immortal, right? That doesn't necessarily mean that all of time is his time. But again, I see what you mean. He wasn't born into a distinct part of the time. So yeah, that's true. But he doesn't have necessarily the full perspective of an immortal person. The incarnation of the wizards is a tricky thing, okay? And I think it's important to remember that the wizards they're not just embodied. It's not just that they have a body. So we know that the Ainur the Valar and the Maiar can manifest themselves in physical bodies, right? And remember, if you remember that part in the Silmarillion, it refers to the idea that they can put on and take off bodies like clothes, right? So they have their sort of their spiritual being, and they can clothe it in flesh if they want to appear visibly and physically, and then they can take it off again like clothes, right? And just walk in sort of this sort of naked spirituality, right? Invisible to most people. But that's true. However, that's not what the wizards are doing, right? The wizards are not merely physically manifested spirits. The wizards are incarnate. They weren't born, right? They don't have moms, right? They didn't come out of a womb, but they do have bodies, not just in the regular sense. They're actually incarnate in physical bodies. So when Gandalf dies, it's not just that his body is destroyed and he has to go make a new one, right? That's not what happens. He's incarnated in that body, and that body dies, and his spirit returns into the West when his body dies. The point of death is a significant one. It's not just a disembodied. This is not just, you know, Gandalf taking off his physical clothes and becoming a naked spirit again. He dies. He is separated from his body in a way which is much more like when a human dies, right? Or even when an elf dies. We see the same thing again when Saruman dies at the end of The Return of the King. When his throat is cut, his body crumbles and his spirit emerges from it and is, of course, blown away by the wind from the west. Anyway, the point, though, again, is that their whole perspective is different. Their relationship with their bodies is different. They have, I mean, like Gandalf has worries and fears. He gets older, right? Remember, we looked at that. We looked at how Gandalf ages Maven, I think your mic is still on, just FYI. Don't want anything accidentally to happen there. He doesn't just have the same perspective that the other spirits have. And I think this is really important because it means that the temptations that the wizards undergo are a different kind of it's not just, are they going to fall like Sauron fell, right? Or like Melkor fell. Their fall is in a different way. In the Unfinished Tales, when Tolkien says that rather remarkable thing that all of the other wizards were a failure, including Radagast, right? That Radagast failed. I have never been really comfortable with that statement that Radagast failed. It doesn't seem to me to hold together. Tolkien's statement about that doesn't make full sense to me. But anyway, what he does say is that he loses track. I mean, he loses his focus. He ceases to concentrate on the task that he's sent. He goes native, right? And he just ends up kind of hanging out with the creatures of Middle Earth. That's something, you know, in other words, he kind of loses sight of his goal, of his purpose. That's something that he can do because he is incarnated. He can just become acclimated to the world around him. It's a temptation that the wizards are subject to that, like Sauron, wouldn't have been subject to in exactly the same way, because Sauron was never incarnated in the same way. He was a spirit who put on physical form. When Sauron's body falls into the abyss with the island of Numenor, what happens to him is not like what happens to Gandalf when Gandalf dies. It's a fundamentally different thing because his relationship with his body is different. Grim, exactly. One could argue that Gandalf spending time with the hobbits is him deviating from his purpose. That, indeed, in Unfinished Tales, is the kind of thing that Saruman kind of suggests when Saruman is giving Gandalf a hard time about spending all of his time hanging out with halflings and smoking. So they do age, though slowly. They experience fear and pain, and when they die, they really die. So in this sense, it's not actually nonsensical for Gandalf to say, so do I also wish that it need not have happened in my time, right? Again, like, does he wish for peace? Like, oh, I wish it, by coincidence, the shadow hadn't happened to arise. No, I mean, again, he's here. But also remember, Gandalf was Okay, I was about to say unwilling. That's not true. He was willing, but not eager. It's another interesting thing that Tolkien says in Unfinished Tales about the wizards, is that Saruman was eager to come over. Gandalf was not eager. Gandalf needed convincing. He didn't want to take that burden on himself. So is there a bit of reluctance? I think there is a bit of reluctance. But not necessarily wishing that you're hoping against hope that he would have a cheerful, pleasant, quiet life. Exactly. Hugo was just thinking the same thing about Aloran not actually being eager to go to Middle Earth. So anyway, this is and this is all tricky, of course. This, don't forget as well, that this is all Tolkien, you know, all of that stuff, all the Silmarillion stuff is really sort of retconned material. When Tolkien wrote most of the Silmarillion, the wizards were no part of it, right? I mean, the addition of Gandalf, the integration of Gandalf into the Silmarillion world is a much later thing. The wizards are definitely not native to that environment. So Okay. But Lincoln, I'm really glad that you brought that up. Another reflection from Lincoln, which I really appreciated. In the latest episode, I discussed Gandalf's assertion that for whatever reason Frodo was meant to have the ring, it was not for any merit that others do not possess, not for power or wisdom at any rate. One of my favorite lines. And what that line might communicate to Frodo psychologically. Yes, I just love that reassurance. Right? Don't worry, it's not because you're special, right? Because you're totally not. Our culture is awash with stories of characters who are heroes or potential heroes because of the nature or circumstances of their births or because they possess a unique and special trait, which most or all of the population does not possess. These characters may or may not be made into heroes over the course of their stories, but heroism is first and foremost something they were born for. That's not how it is in The Lord of the Rings. The hobbits are aggressively ordinary, Sam even more so than Frodo, as he isn't even special by hobbit standards. And as such, they are stand-ins for the readers. And yet they are the ones on whom the fate of the world ultimately rests. They're heroes not because of any merit that others do not possess, but because they stumble into situations where their actions will determine the fates of many, and they rise to the occasion. The message I take away from this is that heroism is not an intrinsic trait, which some people inherently possess and others simply don't. It is rather something that potentially exists in all of us if we ever find ourselves in extraordinary situations. Lincoln, and this is a theme that we're going to come back to a lot, but I think you're absolutely right. Think about the whole, think about the popularity of the superhero genre, right? I mean, that's been booming over the last decade or so, right? I mean, think of the whole, how, you know, like the Marvel Cinematic Universe has taken over, right, recently. It's great. I love those stories, right? They're great stories. I'm a big fan of the Netflix Marvel series. You know, it's great. But Lincoln, exactly as you say, these are all people who are heroes because they are, in fact, special, right? They do have some merit that others do not possess. And the story, of course, is a very different kind of story, right? That is to say, it's like, you know, the classic would be the Spider-Man, the famous Spider-Man line, right? You know, with great power comes great responsibility, right? That's the kind of So Lincoln's right. They don't necessarily all become heroes. They don't all use their power properly, but they do all have that opportunity intrinsically. You know, the drama is, given this opportunity to become a hero if they choose to, are they going to choose to, and are they going to screw it up, and what's going to happen, right? So yes, I agree. The story with the hobbits is very different. And the thing is, surprisingly to me, a lot of people kind of overlook this, especially people who are only kind of superficially familiar with Tolkien, make the assumption or draw the kind of rash conclusion that this black and white story about great and perfect heroes and, you know, ideally perfect villains, right? And it's not really the case at all. I mean, first of all, of course, the heroes are not all perfect in black and white. Tolkien does a better job than any writer I know of sort of showing the shades of gray and how a good guy trying to do good things for good reasons can end up becoming corrupt and evil. However, the thing that people overlook is the hobbits, right? The fact that the whole story, it's not just that the hobbits are the main characters and that they are these sort of ordinary people who don't possess merit that others do not possess, but even more, how the whole story is being told from the hobbit point of view, right? I mean, we get the Lord of the Rings from 3 feet off the ground. That's the person. So, of course, Aragorn looks huge, right? Because he is huge. He towers above the hobbits, right? Not only in physical, but in this kind of moral stature. He is heroic in this sense, but even he, right, within his own frame, is not necessarily just one who is predestined. He is, through the circumstance of his birth, destined to be a hero, and so in that way different from the hobbits. Though, of course, even he is not like Spider-Man exactly, right? It's not exactly a with great power comes great responsibility kind of situation, initially anyway, with Aragorn. But yes, people pay attention to like the characters like Aragorn and Gandalf as, you know, which are these sort of archetypal hero characters, and ignore the fact that the whole frame of the story is from the point of view of the hobbits, and there really is a very great celebration of you know, small hands doing the great things because they must, right? So Link and I agree. I think that that's, good. Tony Mead was talking about hearing Dr. Shippey doing a talk about this and how the fact that Frodo is not made to be a hero makes him a thoroughly modern hero instead of an archetype that comics and myths use. Yes, and Tony, and that's pretty striking. I mean, Tolkien is wonderful at using archetypes and appealing to those kind of mythic roles. But yes, I agree. There is something which is much more distinctly modern about the idea of the Hobbit hero. Good. And Irindis. Is your name designed to evoke Irindis, the Numenorean woman, the queen of Alderaan? Irindis points out that it's easy to overlook that the characters are constantly making choices. Yes, exactly. Even the great characters are constantly making choices, it's something, of course, we're going to be focusing on as we go through. But okay. So let's keep going. All right. T. Thurston says, I read The Lord of the Rings many times before I noticed the brief descriptions about the wind direction, the wind was in the south, for instance, or paid any attention to them. As I understand it, this phrase means that the wind was blowing from the south, yes, so that it was probably warm as it came from warmer lands to the south. Tolkien doesn't tell us the wind was warm, but I guess he expects us to know that a south wind is a warm wind. Of course, we'll see that the direction the wind blows is quite important later in the story, but I think there may be some value in noticing the wind as we read, and thinking about what it tells us. I'm not quite sure of the reason for the capitalization of south, though it's consistent, as in chapter 3, the winds in the west, said Sam, or the west wind was sighing in the branches. I agree, this is the kind of detail, Thurston, that I think is often overlooked, but you can notice if you pay attention. And I also agree that it is often significant, whether it's significant for plot reasons, like, of course, the very important south wind that will be blowing during the Battle of Pelennor Field, right? Or whether it's a west wind, right? West winds are often significant. I've already alluded to one, right, when Saruman is killed and his spirit sort of rises from his body, and then a west wind come and disperses the cloud of his spirit and blows it off into the east. That is a pretty significant west wind, I would say. JJ's teasing me for spoilers. Yeah, this is not designed to be, let me say it this way, JJ. If you're reading The Lord of the Rings for the very first time when you're going along with this class, and you can bear to read for the first time as slowly as we go in this class without ever reading ahead, that's impressive, I gotta tell you. Gilgunthir, I agree. It would absolutely be the longest first read ever. I'm going to read a couple pages a week and no more. The one comment I wanted to throw in about this, Thurston, is I would urge caution, though. That is one temptation, especially once one begins to sort of think of the significance, especially about things like the west wind and stuff like that. There could be a temptation to begin to be thinking in sort of symbolic or allegorical modes. That is to say, to be thinking, this is a symbol, right? You know, the west wind and the south. So when he talks about the north, if there's a north wind in this scene, then it means a particular thing or whatever. I would urge caution against that. It would be tempting to do that. I can see people being tempted to do that, but I would urge caution. It's not normally the way. And here, I mean, I want to speak generally. Many people are very cautious, appropriately very cautious, about reading anything sort of symbolic or allegorical into Tolkien's text because, of course, of Tolkien's instructions about that. He gave very firm instructions about that in the preface, especially to the second edition of The Fellowship of the Ring. He says about how it's not an allegory and don't interpret it allegorically, and he's always cordially disliked allegory ever since he grew old and wary enough to detect its presence. Good Tolkien fans are often very quick to remember that passage and to be resistant to any kind of allegorical reading, and that's good. But of course you have to be careful with that too. He does use allegory. Not usually in The Lord of the Rings, but he does use it. I mean, like, Leif by Niggle, for instance, is a quite thoroughly allegorical story, for instance. And when he sets himself to doing it, he's not bad at it, actually. There is allegory. You can't, you know, don't let yourself be thinking like he doesn't ever think symbolically. He does think symbolically. But I will say it does not at all seem to me to be a mode that's at all sort of natural to him. When he's reaching for a wind direction, when he's doing a landscape description, right, and he's telling you what direction the wind is blowing from, most of the time, it is my belief that most of the time he's just picturing the scene and describing a detail of this scene as he pictures it, right? And he's picturing this. He's usually thinking geographically. He thinks in terms of maps. He thinks in terms of landscape. He was a painter, and he thinks about landscape like a landscape painter thinks about landscape, right? He pictures these things visually in his mind. And that's where all that description comes from, him trying to paint with words this scene that he has very clearly in his mind. So sometimes I believe, many times, the wind that he describes as blowing is either the kind of wind that he believed would be blowing in that area during that season, or B, just sort of the way that he sees this scene happening. It's just the direction of wind is blowing in his picture of it, right? But it doesn't mean that I don't think it's ever symbolic, because I do think that there is a greater symbolic force behind it, often. Not always, but often. So I do think that it's sort of appropriate to be thinking like that. Okay. All right, good. Yeah, Grimm says his descriptions of hiking cross-country are amazingly accurate. You can't appreciate the problems and the way it works until you actually try it. Grimm, I agree, and we're going to actually return to that level of realism later on. It is really important for you to imagine kind of putting yourself into that position in order really to appreciate his descriptions. But okay. Couple more. A couple things about names. Matt DeForest pointed out the name Thane Paladin, right? What seems to be almost an inside joke in that term. So thanes are freeholding servants of a king, and that comes from Old English. Paladin comes from the French tradition and are the peers of Charlemagne, Roland being the most famous. They too are servants of kings and emperors. Any thoughts on the combining of two titles for royal servants into a single name? Yeah, my primary thought, Matt, is that that's exactly the kind of philological joke that Tolkien often made. That kind of thing seemed to really amuse him, actually. One other example, of course, another famous example of this, is the fact that almost every single one of the kings of Rohan, right there, and if you look the entire from Eorl the Young on down, all of their names mean king or ruler or leader, right? There's some kind of synonym of king. So their names literally translate to king. It's fun, right? And again, not exactly a joke, but kind of a joke. I think that I certainly believe that he was privately amused. So yes, I certainly believe that he was amused by the idea of Thane Paladin. Absolutely. T. Thurston also was thinking similarly, especially about Pippin's name.
Peregrine, son of Paladin, took. My dictionary defines peregrine as having a tendency to wander, from the medieval Latin peregrinus. I find it interesting that both of these names, Peregrine and Paladin, seem fitting for members of the Took family, based on what The Hobbit tells us about Tooks, but I find it surprising that both of these names seem to have Latin roots. So, okay, so two elements there. First, I love that observation. Of course, Peregrine, yes, does mean pilgrim. But anyway, I love Thurston's observation that you've got both the wanderlust element, right, and the ruling leadership thane under the king element, right, of the Took line. Both of those things are fitting, as he says, for members of the Took family. That's wonderful. I'd never really thought about it in those terms before, but you're right. In this sense, Peregrine and his dad, Paladin, in their names really sort of show the essence of Tookishness, right? But as for the Latin roots, that's another thing that I think can often get exaggerated. It's true that Tolkien preferred good Old English words with Anglo-Saxon roots rather than Latinate roots. It's also true that he didn't particularly like French and French things, especially French cooking. But again, those things can be really exaggerated. There are many times that Tolkien fans will sort of recall that Tolkien greatly preferred Norse mythology to Greco-Roman mythology. And that's all true. But don't forget, the guy studied classics. I mean, you know, this was a guy who could do extemporaneous Latin or Greek orations. He knew the classics thoroughly and liked them. He didn't diss Latin. He didn't hate Latin and all other Romance languages. What he didn't like was the Norman conquest, right? He didn't like the way that English got spliced together with French. I think if the French had kind of stayed to themselves and not infected the English language, he'd have been fine with them. I think it's possible to expand that. Now to overestimate the significance of that. He does use names with Latin roots, but I would also say the hobbits and hobbit names, he tends to be a little bit more frivolous. Frivolous is kind of a harsh word. I don't mean it to be harsh, but he clearly has fun with hobbit names. I mean, I think that he allows himself to make more jokes with hobbit names. So that it doesn't really surprise me much at all that he would use that kind of use those kinds of names for hobbits. I mean, there are hobbits, you know, Fortinbras is, you know, from Hamlet is a Took name. Am I remembering correctly? Is it Dodinas? Which one of the Arthurian knights is there in the Brandybuck line? I'm forgetting. Whimsical, Tony. You're right. Whimsical is a much better word. Still kind of frivolous too, but I agree with you. I like whimsical better. There are lots of funny names in the Hobbit family trees. So that's all good. Yeah, Fortinbras, exactly. One of everybody's favorites. Okay. So thanks for those observations on names. Finally, Archimago. This is one that Archimago posted a long time ago, and I've been saving this, meaning to come back to this, and we're going to use this as our transition into our actual text tonight. This is our final notes and queries. And Archimago, this was right after we did the first session in Chapter 2, when we were looking at the conversation between Sam and Ted Sandyman. When I think of Sam, the first things that come to mind are his faithfulness and his heroism, but I find it striking that Sam's first starring scene focuses on his imaginative, creative side. Sam's half-chant at the Green Dragon about the elves' departure is marvelous and melancholy, and thus very unhobbit-like. Sam's sigh as he leaves also interests me. Perhaps he is simply annoyed at his failure to interest the local rustics in dragons and elves, but I wonder. I like to think his possibly extemporaneous poem is still on his mind, and the sigh is from a lingering sadness at the thought of the elves leaving Middle-earth. We're told he had more on his mind than gardening. Perhaps he's pondering the next verse of sailing, sailing, sailing. It seems to me that this side of Sam is often overlooked, and Sam the poet dreamer does not get enough credit. Or am I trying to read too much into this scene? No, Archimago, I don't think you're trying to read too much into this scene, and I agree with you. I think it's very striking that this first glimpse that we get of Sam. And I would say, by the way, this is not just the first glimpse that we get of Sam in the book. This is the very first glimpse ever of Sam. When Tolkien invented the character of Sam wasn't in the very first draft. When he went through, when he started the story at chapter one and got as far as Rivendell, in his first real go through, Sam wasn't in there. It was only when he got to Rivendell and started thinking about revisions that he decided he was going to add Sam Gamgee. He writes Sam Gamgee in the margin, and decided to do that. So he was not a first thought; he was a second thought. When he goes back and does the second draft, right? So he gets to Rivendell, stops, starts again, and he rewrites the thing to that point. He writes Sam Gamgee into the story, and the first thing he writes is the conversation with Ted Sandyman. And the conversation between Ted and Sam in The Green Dragon is almost word for word, it's almost identical. Like the final version of that just emerged as soon as Tolkien sat down to write it. So in that way, Archimago, it really is the very first glimpse that anyone ever got of Sam. Tolkien's own first glimpse of Sam is him having that particular debate with Ted Sandyman. And so the wistfulness of his interest in the elves, right, his lamentation over the elves' departure, the way in which he is imaginatively engaged with these stories, we're going to come back to that later on in today. So interesting. Wayalof says that walking home in the evening is also the last glimpse we get of Sam after the elves have gone sailing. Yes, it's how the book ends, right? With Sam walking home in the evening. I agree. So, Mariel, I agree. He does have an innate sense for the mythic. He is, in Archimago's terms, in touch with both the marvelous and the melancholy. Both sides of that are very present to him in ways that they obviously are not to other hobbits. And I do think that it's important that we keep in mind, in a sense, this is the foundation of Sam's character, right? This is the first thing that we see about him. And it's, I think, easy to forget that as we go through. And it's something that I would really like to keep in mind and to carry on focusing on as we move through. But I would say, Archimago, that I think that his sigh is about something else. Let's look at that scene, because that's where I wanted to start tonight anyway. Sam sat silent and said no more. He had a good deal to think about. For one thing, there was a lot to do up in the Bag End garden, and he would have a busy day tomorrow if the weather cleared. The grass was growing fast. But Sam had more on his mind than gardening. After a while, he sighed and got up and went out. Okay, so that's the sigh that Archimago was referring to. Sam had more in his mind than gardening. Now, does this mean, of course, that he's thinking about elves and the departure of the elves as he was just talking about? I mean, probably he was just thinking about that, right? But, I am not sure. I think there may be other things on his mind. Right. Notice several points in this paragraph. Things which, by the way, I would never have noticed and did not notice until, like, not just my second read, like my 22nd read of this book. He had a good deal to think about. So at first it sounds like about the conversation, right? He sat silent and said no more. He had a good deal to think about, right? Well, what are the things that he had to think about? For one thing, there was a lot to do at the Bag End garden, so he had a lot of gardening to think about, and he would have a busy day tomorrow. The grass was growing fast, so specifically our attention is drawn to the fact that he has to cut the grass. And of course, we know he's going to be cutting the grass outside the window tomorrow when Gandalf and Frodo are having their conversation, right? That's our first kind of transition into the idea. Because Sam has more on his mind than gardening. What else is he thinking about? What else is he sighing about? And I think it's pretty clear that he's thinking about Frodo. We will learn in a few chapters that Sam is part of a conspiracy. And I believe it is the conspiracy that he is thinking about. He is not just going to be cutting the grass at Bag End tomorrow. He is going to be cutting the grass and spying on Mr. Frodo tomorrow, which is, of course, exactly what we will see him doing. Remember that paragraph. Okay, here's the end of the conversation between Gandalf and Frodo. But I don't think you need go alone, not if you know of anyone you can trust, and who would be willing to go by your side, and that you would be willing to take into unknown perils. But if you look for a companion, be careful in choosing, and be careful what you say, even to your closest friends. The enemy has many spies, and many ways of hearing. I love that description. Anyone you can trust, who would be willing to go by your side, that you would be willing to take into unknown perils, right? I don't know. Somebody like that doesn't just pop up out of the grass, right? You got to make sure you're really looking carefully for that kind of person, right? Where, oh, where could you possibly find an individual like that? The enemy has many spies and many ways of hearing. Suddenly, he stopped as if listening. Frodo became aware that all was very quiet, inside and outside. Gandalf crept to one side of the window. Then, with a dart, he sprang to the sill and thrust a long arm out and downwards. There was a squawk, and up came Sam Gamgee's curly head, hauled by one ear. "Well, well, bless my beard," said Gandalf. "Sam Gamgee, is it? Now what may you be doing?"
"Lord bless you, Mr. Gandalf, sir," said Sam. "Nothing. Leastways, I was just trimming the grass border under the window, if you follow me."
He picked up his shears and exhibited them as evidence. "I don't," said Gandalf grimly. "It is some time since I last heard the sound of your shears. How long have you been eavesdropping?" Okay. All is very quiet, inside and out. Think about the several different things that are going on in this scene, right? On the one hand, right? We've got Gandalf's setup, right? On the one hand, be cautious, right? You need a companion. It would be good for you to have a companion, but be careful whom you... Make sure it's somebody that you can trust. But wait, it's not just that you have to pick your companions carefully. You have to be aware of the fact that there might be spies, right? And this idea of spies in the Shire. I mean, Frodo is... notice that, like, the hint of paranoia, right? Frodo became aware that all was very quiet inside and outside, right? All of a sudden, this idea of, like, what, spy? Seriously? There might be people spying on me in the Shire? Like, I mean, that's just not a thing that he's used to thinking about or worrying about. Remember how, you know, he had this image of, like, the shadow reaching out to the Shire, right? Reaching out to close around him. You know, that image that he had of being surrounded by darkness, and then he looked up and was surprised to find that it wasn't dark, right? This is Frodo coming to grips with the idea of the shadow reaching toward the Shire, right? The idea that although everything looks peaceful and lovely in the Shire, it's not all peaceful and lovely, right? And now this is like becoming real to him, one more step of becoming real to him, right? The spies lurking outside the window? Holy cow. And then here's Gandalf pulling Sam Gamgee's curly head up by one ear. There was indeed a spy outside his window, right? How long have you been eavesdropping? Gandalf accuses. So Gandalf accuses him of listening on purpose, right? By the way, brief note. This is a question I've gotten several times before. Why does Sam say, "Lord bless you, Mr. Gandalf, sir," right? "Lord bless you" or "Lord bless me" is a phrase that Sam uses twice in this scene. Question, isn't that anachronistic? "Lord bless you" is a Christian expression, right? Isn't it anachronistic for Sam to say that? Not exactly. Not exactly. I don't think so, anyway. Of course, in the Christian context, it is a Christian phrase, and in the Christian context, it means Lord equals God, right? You know, God bless you is what it means, of course. I don't think that's necessarily what it must mean in Sam's mouth, right? The idea that a lower class hobbit would use an expression, the Lord bless you, right? Doesn't seem to me at all strange. We know that culturally the hobbits retain memories, memories which are expressed in colloquial expressions of the lord, of the king, right, who ruled over them, you know, and the king's laws and everything. You know, such expressions as when the king returns or things like that. This, I think, is exactly Grimm. It refers back, I believe, to the time when there was a Numenorean lord ruling the land. I have a very hard time believing that that's just an anachronistic slip that Tolkien missed. He was very sensitive to this and paid very close attention to the expressions that he gives to Sam. So I certainly don't believe that it was a mistake. And yes, JJ, presumably the King of Arnor, not the Witch King. I agree. Interesting. Tony Mead says, I know it's stepping back and looking ahead a bit, but I was struck this time by the fact that Gandalf opens the window to let in the sun when the talk gets too gloomy and scary, similar to what Gandalf does in Meduseld. Is there an implication of driving away the darkness both physically and spiritually? Tony, I mean, yeah, it kind of works that way, right? I mean, the idea of Gandalf saying, let's brighten up the room a bit, or even remember the context of the beginning of the conversation, right? Gandalf he didn't want to have this conversation in the middle of the night, right? Is that a purely symbolic thing? Is there some actual sort of function there, you know, because, you know, the creatures of the shadow have, in fact, greater power in darkness? You know, we don't really know exactly. Simon was just thinking exactly the same thing. By the way, several of you are looking ahead to Sam's immediate response, right? Saying that he hasn't been dropping any eaves, right? You were asking, was Sam, you know, I forget who asked, a couple comments ago. Is Sam, like, playing dumb? Yeah, he's playing dumb, I believe. You know, he's pretending he doesn't even know what Gandalf's eavesdropping? Oh, I have no idea what you're talking about. I ain't been dropping no eaves. Yes, he's playing dumb, trying to get out of it, right? But, of course, Gandalf was like, don't be a fool, right? that is, don't be a fool to try to take me that way. Don't you try to take me for a fool, right? And think, I don't know what you mean. Sarah Lagarde points out, and I think, Sarah, that's a really wonderful point. She says, Sam goes right for the philology with the dropping of the eaves, sort of like Bilbo and Gandalf exploring the meanings of good morning and asking pardon upon first meeting. Yes, it is nicely reminiscent of that, right? And Gandalf's response is like, we're not doing the good morning stuff here, Sam, right? I'm not going to play that game. This is serious. Tell me what you were doing. JJ, I agree. Sam is not exactly a master of super spy level deception. He does not have a cover story prepared, right, when he is actually caught. He won't hurt you, said Frodo, hardly able to keep from laughing, although he was himself startled and rather puzzled. He knows as well as I do that you mean no harm, but just you up and answer his questions straight away. Well, sir, said Sam, dithering a little, I heard a deal that I didn't rightly understand, about an enemy, and rings, and Mr. Bilbo, sir, and dragons, and a fiery mountain, and elves, sir. I listened because I couldn't help myself, if you know what I mean. Lord bless me, sir, but I do love tales of that sort, and I believe them too, whatever Ted may say. Elves, sir, I would dearly love to see them. Couldn't you take me to see elves, sir, when you go? Now notice a couple things here. First of all, Sam is not as dumb as he's playing here. Frodo has just told him to up and answer Gandalf's questions, plural, straight away. And what were Gandalf's questions? Gandalf asks, what did you hear and why did you listen? Right? Notice what Sam does. Right? Sam answers the first question and dodges the second. He answers what he heard. He doesn't answer exactly why he listened, right? He said, I listened because I couldn't help myself, if you know what I mean. He does give an answer. But I think it's kind of a dodgy answer, right, Lincoln? Exactly as you say, he does keep his deeper cover. He doesn't give the conspiracy away. I think, especially in context, you know, when we learn later on about Sam's role in the conspiracy, it's clear that he was not he's not telling the truth here. He didn't just listen because he couldn't help himself. He didn't just happen to be cutting the lawn outside the window and you know, overheard. And by the way, I always believed Sam implicitly when he said that, right? In part, of course, because as Archimago was pointing out, we can see it's the kind of thing Sam would do, right? Because Sam is, in fact, interested in elves, and he would be enchanted by this concept and everything, and upset about hearing that Mr. Frodo was going away and all that sort of thing. He was clearly doing it. And again, this is where we go back with the, remember the, you know, the exhibiting his shears as evidence, right? He's thinking about what he's got to do tomorrow. He's thinking about the grass growing at Bag End, and he had more on his mind than gardening. Yeah, he has spying on Gandalf and Frodo in mind, and he's thinking they're probably going to be sitting right in the parlor at Bag End. The grass is growing, right? So if I get my shears, I can position myself. He's plotting how he can overhear what they're going to say the next day, right? I think he clearly had, and he avoids it, right? He avoids giving that away. He's just like, oh, I listened because I couldn't help myself, right? He doesn't really give an answer for why he clearly, with malice aforethought, right, or benevolence aforethought, in the current case, had plotted to do that. Exactly, Wayloff. Sam's lie has enough of the truth in it to be perfectly in character. Absolutely, absolutely. But notice Frodo's response here. Frodo's reaction, right? He's amused, right? He's hardly able to keep from laughing. I suspect that his three reactions: amusement, startlement, and puzzlement, right? And I think all of these three things are focused on, remember the contrast. Gandalf has just been like, the enemy has many spies and many ways of hearing, right? This sort of freaky idea of the spies of Mordor lurking in the Shire. And then he reaches out his arm and pulls up Sam Gamgee's head. And I think the contrast between paranoia of the spies of the enemy and then Sam, right? And so clearly the idea that the sort of, in Frodo's mind, the juxtaposition of Sam Gamgee's head with the concept of spies of Mordor makes him laugh, right? But he's amused and startled and puzzled, right? Startled because Gandalf has just said this super paranoid thing about, be careful, there are spies everywhere. And then, holy cow, there's actually a spy there. That's kind of startling, right? And a little bit puzzling, like, was he really spying? Like, he's probably not really spying. It's hilarious to think about Sam as a spy of Mordor, but it's interesting, I think, that all, you can see how all three of those things are a response to, you know, him trying to sort of process what exactly was going on here. Frodo clearly buys the response, right? Buys Sam's explanation. So notice what Sam emphasizes, right? He heard about an enemy and rings and Mr. Bilbo, sir, and dragons and a fiery mountain and elves, right? Sam's summary of the conversation. And by the way, I do really like the addition in the film when Sam says, you know, in something about the end of the world. I really like that addition to that. But you notice how, notice what it does. I love that line, but notice how that line in the film shifts Sam to comedy, right? That is, he sort of has a kind of a simple perspective that prompts us to laugh, right? At him, really. Kind of affectionately. But notice what it loses, right? Sam doesn't wind up to a punchline in the printed version, right? In the text, what he comes up to is wonder, right? Exactly what Archimago was pointing to about his conversation in the Green Dragon, right? Elves, sir. I listened because I couldn't help myself. I do love tales of that sort, right? I do love tales of that sort. Listen, think of the difference between Frodo's reaction to this story that Gandalf has been telling him and Sam's, right? You know, here's Frodo, like his entire world has come crashing down. This is like the worst day of Frodo's life. You know, all the things that Gandalf has been telling him, and it's like at the risk of completely overwhelming him. And here's Sam outside the window saying, I do love tales of that sort, right? This is just my kind of thing. And I believe them too, whatever Ted may say, him explicitly alluding back to the conversation, right? So I am not, he says, like other hobbits of the Shire, like Ted Sandyman. I believe in the old tales. As John Usquas says here, Sam's summary is actually a pretty good summary. It's hardly a summary that someone as dumb as Sam is playing here would actually give. Yes, he was paying attention, right? Now there are some elements that he's clearly taken perhaps a little out of context. I mean, like for instance, dragons, right? There are a couple references to dragons, as you know, how some of the dragons destroyed some of the other rings, and how, you know, nor was there ever any dragon, right? So there have been references to dragons, but it's not like they've exactly been telling dragon stories, right? So there are some things which clearly hit Sam's personal interest hot buttons, right? But yeah, he actually does. He actually does get the basic points of the story, but again, from such a different perspective. What it invokes in him is, you know, again, think about, and this is, I think, really fun how we get to see this from a different point of view at the end of this chapter, right? One way in which you could summarize Frodo's experience, right, is all of these stories, Bilbo's stories about the world, right, that he experienced and the adventures that he had, the stories that Frodo has been hearing about Mordor and the Dark Lord and the rise of the Black Tower and all that stuff, right? He's been hearing all these stories, and all of these stories have come real to him, right? They have invaded his everyday world, and now the Dark Lord of Mordor is actually after him personally, right? And he is now not just playing with the idea of going out on an adventure like Bilbo, or trying to find Bilbo. Now he is thrust into this as suddenly and as thoroughly as Bilbo was back in the day, right? So this is what happens to Frodo during the course of chapter 2. Sam is the same thing, right? These stories become real to him, and his reaction to that is wonder, right? Delight. Yes, like all the, I've believed in these stories, but his belief has been a belief of sort of pure faith. He did once thought he saw an elf, but he wasn't really sure, right? He's never met elves. He doesn't even have sort of the kind of the secondhand evidence. Frodo has never been outside the Shire. Frodo's never seen most of these things, but he has seen elves, right? You know, he has more reason than Sam, more experience than Sam does, that would lead you know, to the clear conclusion that there's, you know, more to them, that they're real. With Sam, it's been a more sort of pure faith, right? Which he asserts here. I believe them too. Couldn't you take me to see elves when you go? Yeah, good. Okay. Cecilia, you're absolutely right. So Sam already has some idea that he might be going, might even in a tiny part of his mind want to go. Yeah. Won't you take me to see the elves, sir, when you go? Certainly, Cecilia, we see that Sam's response upon hearing that Frodo is going away is immediately the desire not to prevent him, but to go with him, right? Couldn't you take me when you go? He asks it as a treat, right? Not as a, you know, you're going to need me, but couldn't you please take me with you? Okay, so then Gandalf deems a doom. It can't be helped, Sam, said Frodo sadly. He had suddenly realized that flying from the Shire would mean more painful partings than merely saying farewell to the familiar comforts of Bag End. I shall have to go, but... And here he looked hard at Sam. If you really care about me, you will keep that dead secret, see? If you don't, if you even breathe a word of what you've heard here, then I hope Gandalf will turn you into a spotted toad and fill the garden full of grass snakes. Sam fell on his knees, trembling. Get up, Sam, said Gandalf. I have thought of something better than that. Something to shut your mouth and punish you properly for listening. You shall go away with Mr. Frodo. Me, sir? Cried Sam, springing up like a dog invited for a walk. Me go and see elves and all? Hooray! He shouted, and then burst into tears. I love Frodo's wizardous threat here, right? I hope Gandalf will turn you into a spotted toad and fill the garden full of grass snakes. This is fairly extreme, right? And of course, it's sort of relevant to the immediate context, right? That is before he was infenestrated. Olaf, wasn't that you who talked about the infenestration of Sam in this scene? I still love that. Of course, he was just down in the grass, right? So we're going to put you back in the garden, right? We're going to turn you into a toad and fill the garden full of grass snakes. Is an extreme, but also a slightly absurd request. One thing that interests me about this, it's like, does Frodo even have any idea? Or does he have any idea what Gandalf can actually do? This sort of strikes me as a really interesting glimpse in Hobbit perspective on wizards in general, and Gandalf in particular, right? We know that, like, the other hobbits suspect Gandalf of, you know, hatching dark plots that nobody else understands. So even Frodo, who knows Gandalf better than any other hobbit currently in the Shire, sort of imagines these kinds of things. Could Gandalf really do that? Maybe he could really do that. We never see a wizard doing anything like that. But it seems part of Hobbit lore that wizards might act in that kind of way. Galandar is wondering if the punishment that Frodo is suggesting perhaps might be meant to sound a little lighthearted so that Sam would be put at ease. I don't know, but if it is, it doesn't work, right, as Sam falls on his knees trembling. Remember, Sam believes the stories, right? He's heard stories about wizards and what wizards can do, and he believes them, right? So he falls on his knees trembling. Does he actually say struck by lightning, struck by lightning? I don't know. Amy's Revenge is wondering if this is more a study in what Frodo thinks that Sam might believe. Possibly. James Stevens was just saying the same thing. Possibly. Good. Marielle has a great question. Is Sam loyal to Frodo himself at this point, or is he loyal to the memory of Bilbo, who taught him his letters and told him stories about elves? He clearly is loyal to Frodo. He says he was that upset, right, when he heard that Frodo was going away, that he choked, which Gandalf heard, seemingly. Absolutely. I think that he is definitely loyal to Frodo, but clearly reveres Mr. Bilbo, definitely. Good. Benjamir, my guide on our procession earlier this evening, says the wise and well-read likely grasp what wizards could do, but someone like a wizard would surely avoid overt displays of power, so as not to create fear among those that are there to serve. To do otherwise would be akin to Sauron or his followers. Yes, absolutely. Gandalf wouldn't act like this, and so would never really confirm, right, or deny that the wizards are able to do that kind of thing. And yes, Karita, it is the image of the snake eating the toad, which is going to be it is a very garden-centered kind of punishment, right? Which would certainly hit Sam. Yeah, good. Wayalov says, please don't throw me in the briar patch, Mr. Gandalf, sir. Yeah, exactly. Something like that. Okay, good. Yeah. Now, Veronica asks a great question. You know, is Frodo just teasing Sam here? I mean, is it, we see, you know, hobbits kind of giving each other grief all the time. This is a thing that hobbits do, and we've talked about this. Is this the same kind of thing? I think the tone is sort of different here, right? Then I hope Gandalf will turn you into a spotted toad and fill the garden full of grass snakes. Again, it's a little over the top, right? I think it could possibly be. But again, Sam clearly doesn't take it that way. And one other thing, Veronica, that I would point to, Frodo and Sam are not social equals. You'll see Frodo and Sam very rarely engaging in that kind of repartee, right? They rarely banter like that. Frodo banters heavily with Merry and Pippin in that way, because they're peers. Sam is his servant, and therefore Frodo always speaks to Sam generally kindly and affectionately, with very little of the kind of banter that he gives to those who are his peers and friends. Okay. Now, Cecilia, thinking back to what Sam was saying about his eagerness to go, Cecilia is wondering if, do I think Sam truly understands how great the danger is? He heard all that conversation, but has the true meaning hit him? Yeah, well, one thing, Cecilia, of course, it's going to hit Frodo differently, right, than it's going to hit Sam. I mean, they're not after Sam personally. But I think there are a couple different ways we could read that, right? One is, as again, that it's kind of gone over Sam's head a little bit. He's not really thinking it through thoroughly, and doesn't really realize the full danger. But I don't think so. I think that Sam's wonder is overwhelming his fear here.
If you've read On Fairy Stories, you may remember that Tolkien talks about the tendency that children have when listening to a fairy story to ask the question, is it true? He acknowledges that kids do ask this question, but he says what kids usually mean when they ask, is it true, is, am I safe in my bed, right? Are there giants, in fact, in the next county over, right? Is a dragon going to come into this room, right? Is it going to set fire to the top of the next hill, like, you know, in Bilbo's little sort of vision in chapter one of The Hobbit? Because, of course, the spirit may be bold, but the body is weak and fearful. Okay, these are what Tolkien talks about in On Fairy Stories. Sam, it seems to me, is one who loves fairy stories, elf stories, so much that he is not worried about the danger. He would, if he could know for sure that the stories about dragons were true and the stories about the elves were true and all these things were true and real, he would buy that at the cost of danger. It's worth it. Knowing that the Dark Lord is out there and is hunting Mr. Frodo and coming to invade the Shire, it's worth that price to be actually immersed into this world of fantasy, right? Into this fairy tale world in which he's always believed. I believe in dragons. I believe in elves. It seems that I think that Sam is basically, he's not worried because he's brave. Of course, Sam is brave, but that's not his first thought. And I think that that's really fascinating. James says all Sam hears is elves. Yes, exactly. Sam is like, you had me at elves, right? Yeah, exactly. And as Tony says, this is the moment when, as the gaffer would say, Sam gets into trouble that's too big for him. Yes. And remember back to that conversation? This is the part of the conversation between Gaffer Gamgee and Ted's dad, right? Mr. Sandyman the Miller. And he says, remember, it's when he talks about Bilbo teaching Sam to read, right? that Mr. Bilbo's learned him his letters, meaning no harm, mark you, and I hope no harm comes of it. And of course, you could say, well, harm did come of it, right? Here's Sam becomes all literate and starts reading stories. And when he reads stories, now look at the danger that reading these stories has gotten him into, right? And as in the passage that Tony was referring to right afterwards, Gaffer quotes the advice that he gave to his son Sam, right? Don't get mixed up with the business of your betters, or you'll land in trouble too big for you. And he does land in trouble that's too big for him, right? And here he is getting messed up in the business of his betters. Okay, so good. All right, so let me move on before we totally run out of time. We're going to get to chapter. Okay, well, so last thing here, of course, is Sam's mixed reactions, right? This is the other thing that convinces me that it hasn't all gone over his head. He does, in addition to saying hooray, he does also burst into tears, right? The fact that he has both of these reactions, I don't believe that these are just tears of joy, right? That he's like, hooray, and I'm crying because I'm happy. Like, he is crying because he's happy, but I think Sam also realizes, right? He's scared to leave home. He's never left home before. He's never even left Hobbiton before, right? Much less the Shire. Frodo is well-traveled in comparison, and Frodo's never left the Shire. I think that his tears are real tears. I think that he's sad to leave. I think that he's afraid. He's scared. But he says hooray and really means it, right? He really means both. I definitely see both of those things involved there. Irendis calls it emotional overload. Yes, yes, exactly. Oh, and Lincoln, one last point. Of course, notice this idea of Sam getting mixed up in the business of his betters, right? Just like the heroism stuff that you were talking about, right? In a sense, that's what being a hero is, right? Being a hero is being, you know, a person of not any exceptional merits, but being such a person who gets mixed up in the business of your betters, right? Being put, in other words, into a heroic position. And, you know, it's not you, right? You don't have the capabilities, but you got to do what you've got to do. Okay. And now, are you ready? Chapter 3. Look at that. We got there. You ought to go quietly, and you ought to go soon, said Gandalf. 2 or 3 weeks had passed, and still Frodo made no sign of getting ready to go. I know, but it is difficult to do both, he objected. If I just vanish like Bilbo, the tale will be all over the Shire in no time. Of course you mustn't vanish, said Gandalf. That wouldn't do at all. I said soon, not instantly. If you can think of any way of slipping out of the Shire without its being generally known, it will be worth a little delay. But you must not delay too long. What about the autumn, on or after our birthday? Asked Frodo. I think I could probably make some arrangements by then. Okay. If you can think of any way of slipping out of the Shire without its being generally known, it will be worth a little delay. So first of all, a little delay, apparently 6 months counts as a little delay, right? Because that's what we're talking about here. It's early, right? In this scene, it's months before they're actually going. It would be worth it. So let's kind of talk about this. This is another moment where, of course, Gandalf can come across looking bad, right? Poor planning on Gandalf's part. First of all, let's not forget the fact that Gandalf would be the first to admit this, right? Gandalf will admit this, that he made a very serious mistake here. But there's a bunch of things going on here that it's really important for us to remember. Not just the fact that we can't merely look back at this with hindsight, right? Again, when Gandalf looks back on this with hindsight, he's going to call this the worst mistake he ever made. But nobody knows. there's no reason to know that the Ringwraiths, the Black Riders, are even, they don't even know or suspect they've left Mordor, right? Much less that they're closing in on the Shire and as close as they are to figuring things out. Gandalf has literally no way of even guessing that that's going to be the case. So let's kind of back up and think about things a little bit here. First, notice Gandalf's priorities. You ought to go quietly and you ought to go soon. Clearly in that order, quietness matters more to Gandalf than soonness, right? Don't leave instantly, whatever you do. So if he were to leave instantly in a way that will cause talk, or that will be generally known, that's not as good as leaving quietly several months from now, right? That's very clear in Gandalf's book. So why should that be? What's Gandalf's thinking here? Why does he have those priorities in that order? Three things that I would urge us to remember in thinking about this. Thing number one, again, Gandalf does not know that the Ringwraiths are in pursuit. What he knows, as he's explained to Frodo, Sauron knows that Baggins of the Shire has the ring and he's going to be hunting for you. What does Gandalf assume? He says explicitly later on that he had no idea that it would be the Ringwraiths. And the Ringwraiths being sent on this trip is actually a bit of a surprise. That's not something that was actually sort of easy to foresee. Gandalf obviously is sort of imagining human spies, right? Maybe, possibly, conceivably, some hobbits might have been corrupted or something, but even that is really unlikely. So Gandalf has pretty good reason to think that any spies of Mordor are going to be are going to stick out like a sore thumb in the Shire, right? They're going to see them from a long way off because they're not going to blend in, right? If there's like random men traveling through the Shire asking questions, that's going to become really obvious, right? So there's no reason to think that pursuit is anywhere close. And he certainly doesn't think that it's going to be the Ringwraiths. So that's one thing. Second thing, Middle Earth is huge. And we have to remember how big Middle Earth is. And it's not just that it's big. This is where we have to imaginatively invest ourselves in this pre-modern world, right? And this is something, it's an imaginative leap that a lot of modern readers really fail to make. Because the world is huge. And it's not just that it's big. There's no mass transit, right? You can't get anywhere fast, and there's no communication. We are so spoiled. The world has come to seem very small to us now that you can constantly be getting news updates about what's going on, you know, in the Ukraine or in Australia or whatever. We're used to instantly communicating with people all over the world. We're used to traveling, you know, like me just popping down to Texas and back for a day and a half last weekend. That kind of thing is totally impossible, right? I mean, I remember having this conversation with my kids and trying to get them to embrace this. You know, we moved up to New Hampshire so we'd be closer to my family, and in large part, I have three siblings. My parents, my siblings, and our families, they're all here in southern New Hampshire. So one day we're driving over to my sister's house to see the cousins, lots of cousins. My family, my sister's a big family. And we're driving over there. It's like a 15-mile drive. It takes us like half an hour to get there. And, I was trying to impress upon my kids, like, think about this. How long do you think it would take you to get there if you didn't have a car, right? And we're sort of realizing, yeah, it would be that's just two towns over from here, right? In my tiny little state of New Hampshire, that would be a day's journey, a long day's journey to get there, especially given the terrain that you'd have to cross. It's uphill to get to my sister's house. And we don't even think about that, right? it's easy for us to kind of look at the Shire and be like, oh, those parochial hobbits, right? You know, Gaffer Gamgee with his whole, like, folks are queer over there, right? But that's, of course, how it, that's normal, right? That's just how things would always be. Somebody never to travel more than 20 miles away from their hometown is perfectly normal, right? I mean, you just wouldn't do that. How could you do? How could you afford to do that? When would you have the time to travel that kind of a distance? So remember the situation. Yes, on the one hand, Sauron knows Baggins in the Shire. Remember, there also aren't even maps. It's not just that they don't have the internet, right? It's not just that they don't have airplanes. They don't even have cartography, right? They don't have published maps. There won't be any map that Sauron will have ever seen that has the Shire labeled on it, right? So the first thing that his servants have to do is go wandering out into the Western world, wandering around Eriador saying, has anybody ever heard of a land of halflings, right? Does anyone know where there's a bunch of little people living, right? And nobody has, and so you keep wandering around until you find it. I mean, the distance, traveling the distance on horseback, if you know straight where you're going, is months and months and months, right? If you have no idea even which direction to go and you're wandering up and down and your Grim is asking, would they even know that they are halflings? Maybe even not, right? Probably. You probably tortured that out of Gollum. Maybe you got enough of a description to sort of know that. I think it's possible. But anyway, yeah, yeah, exactly. People joking about just saying, you know, Siri, find Baggins. Exactly. That there's just no way for them to do anything like that, right? So even if he knows that the Dark Lord is coming, right, there is no reason to think that Sauron is going to be able to find Frodo in a year, 2 years, 3 years. It could be 5 years. It could be a decade. It could be 50 years before he finds out exactly. Probably less time than that because he has a lot of servants who can cover a lot of ground, right? But anyway, it's there's no reason for them to think there's this kind of urgency. Right, even knowing that the Dark Lord is after them, if you remember the size of the world and the state of technology and the kind of blind search that the servants of Sauron are entering on, and Gandalf knows better than anybody else how little anyone else in the world knows about the Shire and where the Shire is. Even the wise don't even really know. The best thing they have to go on, remember, is that people in the greater Erebor region knew that Bilbo had come from the west and was headed back and was last seen headed off in that direction, right? So vaguely north and west from Mordor and on the other side of the Misty Mountains. So he only has, like, you know, Eriador to cover instead of all of Rovanion too. But still, there's a heck of a lot of space over there and a whole lot of open country where there aren't even people to ask questions of. So yes, exactly. Sarah Lagarde points out that a blind search by the Ringwraiths is true in more than one sense. Absolutely. So we have to remember that. The third thing that we do have to remember is that Sauron's directions are quite vague and his knowledge is very limited. Knowing that he lived in a land called the Shire would not help. Nobody else has heard of the Shire, right? There's lots of reasons for Gandalf not to be worried and think that there's any urgency with Frodo's leaving. But this is exactly why his first priority is to prevent talk, right? Because if the disappearance of Frodo Baggins creates a sensation that everybody is talking about, right? There might be, remember, even at the Prancing Pony in Bree, they heard stories about Bilbo's departure, right? The story of the vanishing of Bilbo Baggins was heard in Bree, right? Therefore, if word gets around, if it becomes a 9 days wonder, if everybody's discussing it,
then that is the thing that's going to give them away more than that's much more important, right? That could make the search, succeed much, much more quickly. And yes, Simon, you're absolutely right that, in Eriador, of course, you do have the Rangers to deal with, who would also be, as we know from playing Lotro, faithfully sitting next to campfires, but presumably remaining vigilant and looking for the servants of Sauron who would be spying out the place. Yeah, so that would also make things difficult. And again, Gandalf knows about that. Yes, sitting next to campfires and not learning the Black Speech, Simon. Exactly. It's just what they're up to. Okay, we are almost out of time here tonight. Let me do one more. For where am I to go? And by what shall I steer? What is to be my quest? Bilbo went to find a treasure, there and back again, but I go to lose one and not return as far as I can see. But you cannot see very far, said Gandalf. Neither can I. It may be your task to find the cracks of doom, but that quest may be for others. I do not know. At any rate, you are not ready for that long road yet. No, indeed, said Frodo. But in the meantime, what course am I to take? Towards danger, but not too rashly, nor too straight, answered the wizard. If you want my advice, make for Rivendell. That journey should not prove too perilous, though the road is less easy than it was, and it will grow worse as the year fails. Rivendell, said Frodo. Very good. I will go east, and I will make for Rivendell. I will take Sam to visit the elves. He will be delighted. He spoke lightly, but his heart was moved suddenly with a desire to see the house of Elrond Hethelven and breathe the air of that deep valley where many of the fair folk still dwelt in peace. Okay. All right. So notice Frodo's uncertainty here, right? I mean, it's one thing for him to say, as he said at the end of chapter one, like, I'll have to go into exile. Right. I'm going to leave the Shire. But he, when it comes to actually thinking about, like, but I have to go somewhere. Right? Where do I go? Where do, you know, the his true rootlessness, his purposelessness compared again to Bilbo, right? You know, Bilbo went to find a treasure there and back again, right? I go to lose one and not to return. As far as I can see, Bilbo always had a goal, right? His goal was always to get to the mountain, though really it was get to the mountain and to come back again, right? His destination was always the hill by way of the mountain, right? Frodo has nothing to steer by, right? He has no goal. Maybe the cracks of doom, says Gandalf, but maybe not. We'll see. Right. But in any case, in the meantime, what course am I to take? Make for Rivendell. Right. That is the initial his initial advice. Frodo's response, I think, is really important. Right. We see his desire. Right. Like Sam, Frodo, too, loves Bilbo's story. Stories, right? He also wants to see the house of Elrond Half-Elven. He has been hearing Bilbo's stories about his journey, you know, his stories about Rivendell for his whole life. We saw that as soon as he made his choice to embrace this responsibility and to take the ring and guard it and to leave and sacrifice his own life in order to save the lives of others, the first thing that arose in him, as if it were a reward for the choice that he made, or in response to the choice that he made, was desire, right? Positive desire to run out the door and to follow Bilbo. And he immediately feels this same desire again. His heart is moved suddenly with the desire to see the house of Elrond Half-Elven and breathe the air of that deep valley. By the way, that line always kind of puzzled me a little bit, like, breathe the air of the valley. What's special about the air? What could be special about the air? Much could be special about the air. I used to think that that was metaphorical, right? There's a certain air, you know, about that.
No, it's, there's literally something in the air. And remember, exactly, Tony, this is the same response that we know that there's something in the air in that valley, right? That when the fair folk, when the elves are dwelling in this place, it changes the actual air in the valley. Bilbo smells it, right? As soon as he gets, that's what it means. That's why Bilbo says it smells like elves. Right? Because elves actually have a smell. It's not like elvish body odor that he's smelling. He's smelling the air, literally the air of the valley. John Osglass asks, might it have to do with the ring of air? No, I don't think it does, actually. It's just an elf thing. It's in the Silmarillion material. We learn that there is an air thing. Like, elves need to breathe the air of Middle-earth. They can't live. It's like oxygen deprivation, except non-scientific. If they live in Valinor without access to the air that comes in from the great lands. I'm not kidding. When you hear about, so I used to think that when Tolkien talked about the air and the air of Middle-earth, that he meant that just figuratively. He was sort of speaking broadly about the sort of spirit of things and whatever. I have ceased to believe that Tolkien is speaking. From what I've seen, he actually is speaking literally about the air that is breathed. I actually think... I think that he means the, like, I don't know, again, he doesn't do it scientifically, right? I mean, is it like an oxygen saturation thing? I don't really know, but it's, but it's, sorry, Hugo was just saying Fey breeze, right? Yes, exactly. Fey breeze. Something like that. Wayalof says it's like there's something in the water of the Entdrafts. Exactly. Elf air, the air is to the elves what the water is to the Ents, something like that. I think it's like that. Bilbo's smelling, like, right? The smells like elves line is the one that that I think it really kind of seals that for me more. And again, all those early Silmarillion references. And Cecilia, yes, it is Elrond who does have the Ring of Air. But again, I don't think that that really has to do with it. I think that I think that Lorien smells like elves too. But we'll see. Mariel asks, is it like how in the Silmarillion the men and Moriquendi who spend time with the returned Noldor grow in stature and wisdom? Yes, exactly. And of course we see that, we'll see that in the Lord of the Rings, as well. Exactly. And that there's this actual sort of physiological connection. But anyway, okay. Good. See, Irendis, we're not going to get to this passage for months, but in The Ring Goeth South, Irendis is recalling, Gandalf's comment, there is a wholesome air about Holland. Much evil must befall a country before it wholly forgets the elves, right? See, elves used to live there, so the air, literal air, is more wholesome in Holland than in other places. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's a literal change in the air. It's an effect. But I think, going back to what Marielle was saying, exactly the kind of influence that the elves have, it's like the outward manifestation of the way, like when you hang out with elves, when you breathe in the air that the elves live in, right, you're changed. Like, it changes you. You breathe that in and it becomes part of you. And yes, you grow, right, in stature as a consequence. So, yeah, Okay. All right. It is time to stop. Next week, we will spend all of our time in Chapter 3, and we'll look at the beginning of the journey. I don't know if we'll get as far as the meeting with Gildor, but I certainly hope that we will get to the Talking Fox and to the Ringwraiths, the intervention of the Black Riders. So, all right. It's field trip time. Let's do our field trip this evening. So tonight we are going to go back to Mickle Delving. What I want to do, thinking about setting out on journeys and things, I want to look at the quest line. See, one of the problems with the epic quest line is that we don't get the true beginning. If you recall, and I've mentioned this before, if you start a Hobbit, especially, I think it's a Hobbit. I don't think it's, is it men too? Or no, I think it's just Hobbits. If you start a Hobbit character in Lotro, the intro area that you have to go through at the beginning starts with you being standing by the side of the road and seeing Frodo, Sam, and Pippin go by. So you're in Chapter 3, in other words, when the epic quest begins. Therefore, we don't get the real beginnings of the story, the beginnings of adventure and the setting off on adventure. So what I would like to do, I really enjoy the Bingo Boffin quest line, the adventures of Bingo. And I want to do the beginning of the Bingo quest, looking at that in the context of thinking about Chapter 2 and Chapter 3 as we begun looking at it here, this decision to set out, where Frodo and Sam are at that stage there, again, at the, in the passages that we were looking at today. And I want to look at how Lotro handles the beginnings of adventure. Now, of course, the beginnings of Bingo's adventure are much more like the beginnings of Bilbo's adventure, right? Frodo is not setting out from scratch in ignorance of all these things. And of course, his setting out is a much more solemn kind of thing, even than Bilbo, and certainly than Bingo Boffin. But I really am interested in how they handle that and how they look at Hobbit culture and things and how they sort of apply Hobbit culture within the context of those quests. So that's what I want to do. Are we ready, Maven? Are we okay just to ride over there, to stable master over there? Okay. All right.
I thought I was not muted.
You were.
Before we go, I'd like to have Benjamir come up. There's one thing that he would like to talk a little bit about.
Absolutely.
The kinship does. So
yeah.
Before we do that, and then we can go. Are you unmuted?
I'm officially unmuted, yes. Well, thanks again for allowing us to escort you in for the lecture tonight. It is, of course, always a flattering and honor, you know, to be able to participate in these things in any way and form. One thing I wanted to plug, and Maven was good enough to cede me a few seconds to do this, was to make people aware of our forthcoming August scheduled LotroCon. It's something we've done 4 times in the past. We took a pass last year during the server merges, but we are looking to gather again socially. Date within August to be pinpointed based on kinships that want to participate, but we will be gathering at Cedar Point Amusement Park in northern Ohio on the shores of Lake Erie. And it's a purely social thing. The main event will take place on a Saturday, which is pretty much folks gathering for everything from swilling ale and Tolkien trivia to the obviously lore-rooted tradition of riding massive steel roller coasters at high speed.
Yes.
But if you're not familiar with it, keep an eye on lotrocon.com. That's our Facebook page that we have set up, and we're going to be doing the scheduling and basically coordinating and communicating it through there, and hope more folks will come north if they have the time and the means, and spend a few days in the sun just having fun, not in front of a computer.
Cool.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
Sounds like something Mythgard could definitely get behind.
I agree. Was definitely thinking the same thing.
Thanks for the time.
Thank you. Thank you, Benjamir, and thanks to the Sons of Numenor for for bringing our illustrious professor in tonight. Well, hopefully we'll be able to do this again. But now it's time to go to Mickle Delving.
All right.
So folks have ports and horses and whatnot. I can take people if anybody needs to be ported. Come up here and I'll fellow up any other hunters that want to do that. My buddy Darren Thalion over in the corner over there also is offering. He's a hunter. Other than that, you know, you can get the horse from the West Gate, or I know a lot of folks probably have milestones and stuff. So,
very good. All right,
yeah, you better leave first because nobody's leaving before you leave.
All right, so. I'm heading out. We're going to Stablemaster.
Okay, great.
And we're gonna find him here. I'm going the wrong way. Gosh, it's been so long since I've been here. I don't even remember which way to turn at the top of the stairs. Getting lost on my way out of the lore hall for crying out loud. Yeah, that was.
May, you need a ride? One of our new kinnies.
Cool. All right. So, just a little context for people who are not familiar with the game. This quest line of Bingo Boffin was just introduced relatively recently. When was it? A couple, like 2 years ago that it started? Something like that?
Yeah, I think so.
But, you know, it was this new quest line which began out here in Mickle Delving, and it starts at like level 8, so you can begin it at the very, you know, at very low levels, and it goes all the way up through level 93. And it's this long contiguous story that's totally unconnected with the epic quest line. The epic quest line has, you know, the PC sort of paralleling the story, you know, the primary story of the Lord of the Rings, and that's, you know, it's all very interesting, you know, and it's really cool to be going along and threading your way through along sort of parallel to the path of the Fellowship. But this storyline is a totally independent storyline, totally optional. Of course, you don't have to do it, and a lot of people don't. But I think it's pretty nifty. So we're gonna head over there. Let's see, for Maven, how many people are still coming? We got.
I think we're good. I think we've got everybody. There's going to be a couple people that are AFK back in the lore hall, but hopefully
right.
They'll catch up with us.
Okay, exactly. Okay. Now, right, July of 2015 is when it began. Yeah, so almost 2 years.
Okay.
Exactly. JJ48 says, if you're going to skip Bingo Boffin, why even bother downloading the game? See, there you go. So let's... find where... Oh, here, I've wandered into the gardens here. You'll remember the Burden Baby Pub is right over there that we went to. Here's the center of town. Right up here, we've got the Mayor Flower Dumpling, right? There's a little Woodfoot right there. And if we go right around the corner from them in this little Hobbit neighborhood... Right over here lives Bingo Boffin. Of course, I was excited as soon as I heard about the Bingo quest, even just because of his name.
A pleasant day to you, friend.
Because it suggested to me that they are, you know, that they were going to be paralleling the books. Because of course, Bingo was Frodo's original name, and you know, before Tolkien changed the name from Bingo to Frodo. In the Return of the Shadow class, we're in the second draft. We're going to be actually looking at the second draft of chapter 2, which we've just spent the last month and a half doing here. So we're going to be looking at Tolkien's second draft of that, and it's still Bingo, right? We still have not yet gotten to the point in the Return of the Shadow where he changes the name from Bingo to Frodo. Bingo Boffin, and I love the titles that he's given. He's a lonely homebody here at the beginning. That's Bingo and where he starts. So at the beginning here, right, Bingo says, pleasant day to you. He asks just if he could trouble us, right, if we could possibly help him. What help does Bingo need? Right, he's of the Delving Field Boffins, and it's rare for him to see new folk.
So first thing, notice that he finds it a pleasure to meet strangers. This already makes him an unusual kind of hobbit, right? On the one hand, he's kind of typical. He's a typical stay-at-home, mickle-delving citizen. But he doesn't just look at us as, you know, a bunch of queer folk from out of town. And honestly, looking at this crowd, he could be forgiven for thinking that we looked rather queer. But that's not his reaction, right? He's interested in new people, and he strikes up a conversation and indeed asks us for help. And I even love the reference, for me to see new folk on the path that runs by my hole. Even the reference to the path running by his hole reminds me of the Road Goes Ever On song, right? And how, you know, the there's only one road and its tributaries are at every doorstep, right? Bingo Boffin may never have heard Bilbo's song, but there's almost this sense in which he has the same instinct, right? Which I think is pretty cool. But he admits he's been feeling a mite lonely and thinks he could use a festive occasion to put a spring in his step and to occupy his thoughts, maybe a dinner party. So this is his idea. He's going to throw a dinner party. Now, notice again the parallel, right? The parallel between Bilbo at the beginning. Now again, this is not 13 dwarves descending upon him and throwing a dinner party that he wasn't planning, right? We have Bingo the other way around, right? He sees strangers come by and says, hey, I have an idea. Let's throw a dinner party. So again, we see how his perspective is even more adventurous than Bilbo's was at the beginning. So he wants us to run down to the Mickledelving Market and assess the produce on display. So we're going to see what we can purchase for his theoretical dinner party. He wants to know what looks particularly delicious. So, okay. So we're going to go and I'm going to make sure I'm pointed in the right direction here. There we go. We're going to head down to the market and assess the wares. Because this would be a long walk for a hobbit, right? Bingo can't be bothered. So let's find the market and we'll do some assessing of what is for sale. Jono's Glass asks if he's going to throw his dishes out of the top floor windows. Yeah, we'll see. That's a Return of the Shadow joke conversation that basically Frodo, Pippin, and Odo have when they're on the road. If my pie goes anywhere, he doesn't like the way that we're staring at his pie. Hugo Broadbelt's pie, right? We assess the pie. It smells wonderful, but it belongs to Hugo. Look at all the unfriendly things Hugo is saying. Eyes off my pie. If my pie vanishes, I'll know whom to blame. So, okay. So we're scoping the pie, but Hugo doesn't appreciate it. So let's look around here. What else do we have? Something in a bucket over here. A tub of taters. There we are. A tater tub. Let's look at the taters. And particularly good taters here. They would be very fine boiled mashed or stewed. So there we go. We even have some simple recipe ideas. What's this here? Crate of vegetables. Let's check out the veggies. Okay, a selection of greens looks tasty. Okay. And what's the apples? Crates of apples. Okay, let's assess the apples. Ripe, firm, and delicious. Okay. All right, so we have to report on these important matters back to Bingo. So let's mount back up, head back to Bingo, and let him know what looks good in the market here today. So we'll head through. I'm stuck. There we are. Okay, right past the big carved statue of the discoverers of the Shire and their mom. And now we'll leap over fences and we'll go. We look like an English fox hunt here. Leaping over fences, breaking down hedges, galloping over fields. Okay, Bingo. Things look great.
Capture your fancy?
It did capture my fancy. I think it looks pretty good. That is both a wonderful thing and a pity because it makes it very difficult to decide what to serve at my party. I see you were hoping for help of that kind. I need more than just an account of the ingredients. I need a cookbook. There's a library in the Great Smiles. Would you mind terribly a quick trip to the library to check out a cookbook on my behalf? Perhaps leafing through such a book would give me a good idea of what to serve. Okay. So we're going to head over to the Great Smiles in Tuckborough and find a recipe in the cookbook. Now, it is interesting, of course, that he's sending us to Tuckborough, as first of all, Tuckborough is far away. Bingo Boffin can't be bothered even to come down to the market. Much less, apparently, is he going to go all the way to Tuckborough, which is really quite a fur piece from Mickledelving. Now, of course, I've been talking about... right here, I know I'm going the long way around. Lots of people on up ahead who took the shortcut there. I was talking about how big the world is in Middle-earth and how you have to remember that you can't just... get from one place to another instantly, and you've got to remember the days and weeks and months and even years that it takes to travel any significant distances in Middle-earth. Well, playing Lotro will not enhance that perception of Middle-earth. It's, of course, one of the things which is most persistently unrealistic, of course, and untrue to the books. If you want to ask, like, what one way has, is the Lotro world least faithful in its representation of Middle-earth, of course, the primary answer has to be the scale. Obviously, it doesn't give any real sense of the scale of Middle-earth, and that's very understandable. I mean, you wouldn't really want to play a game where you had to spend a month just traveling from one spot to the next. So, of course, the scales are quite small, and it takes no time at all to gallop from... it took us only a matter, even to walk in the form of a chicken. It only took me, 5 hours or so to walk from Mickledelving all the way to Minas Tirith, even on my waddling little chicken legs. And that's just the way of the video game world. So let's see, Donamira. Donamira took librarian.
Yes? Can I help you find something in particular?
Yeah, cookbook. And she says, there's no day that cannot be brightened with a tasty meal shared by friends. So, okay, so we're going to look. Let's see. I got to look at the shelf here. We got to wait for the books to respawn. Okay, I'm checking out the cookbooks. Or no, they're being checked out, but hang on. I got to wait again for the books to respawn. And I thought I could just click on the shelf, but no, I actually have to wait for books. Okay. All right. I picked up a book. She smiles and writes down my name on a piece of parchment. This is the lending library, right? We don't want to be the subject of satirical gifts about being a prodigious borrower of books and being worse than usual at returning them. Okay, so we come to the library, ultimately the library of the old Took himself. Hey, Paladin. Thane Paladin, as we were discussing your name earlier on. Okay. Why Tuckborough, right? It's interesting that Bingo chooses Tuckborough as a place to send us in order to get his... in order to get a cookbook for his adventure. One reason for this, I think, one thing that we can see here... All right, I guess I'll go overland. Head out the straight way towards Mickledelving, I guess. Not go around by the whole road. Anyway, one reason for this is that it's kind of prestigious, right? We know that Tuckborough is sort of the traditional center of the Shire. It's where the Thane lives. It's got a big library, which, Mickledelving doesn't have a library, right? So, of course, we are being sent to Tuckborough in order to check out a book, right? But, of course, it seems to me significant that it is from the Tooks, ultimately. It is Tooks that are going to be the impetus of Bingo's adventure. And this, of course, is another parallel between Bingo, Boffin, and Bilbo. Right? That Bilbo... It was Bilbo's Took side, which wins the battle with his Baggin side briefly there, right? Though he comes to regret it later on in his sitting room there in Bag End. Bingo doesn't have a Took side, exactly. He seems to be 100% Boffin, and yet he it's going to be from Tuckborough that you know, the trouble comes here. All right, so we return to Bingo with his cookbook. Let's see if I can click
this
on Bingo.
This looks like just the thing. Wait, what's this?
And out of the cookbook, a folded parchment falls, and it's a map. Someone left a map in the cookbook, and the Barrow Downs, the Weather Hills, the trolls, the Stone Trolls Glade. Look at these little pictures. Do you think these are real places? And at first he puts it aside, right? I've got a party to plan, and he tells you to bring the map to the Matham house. He doesn't need it, and he doesn't want it, right? So he sees the map, he's interested in it, but he rejects it, right? He's gonna push it aside and focus on throwing his party, because that is what's going to break him out of his normal life, right? But again, this is a Tookish map, right? A map from an adventurous Took who clearly has been, well, as far as the Trollshaws, anyway, right? Okay. So we're supposed to take it to the Matham house, because the Matham house is where you take stuff that you don't really want or need, right? It's interesting. He doesn't want to lose it. You know, it seems like a thing that should be collected. The Matham house, it's easy to think of the Matham house as a museum, right? And it kind of is a museum. But it's, I don't know. Museum makes it seem sort of more grand and important than the Matham house in Mickledelving really seems to be. Things seem to go to get left here and to collect dust, and people don't really seem to think all that much of them. So let's talk to Brombard Foxtail. Tell him we have this map.
Good day.
Yeah, so we have this unloved and unwanted object with no place to go, but cannot bear to throw it away. Hand it over, and I will make sure it joins other Mathems of its type in my keeping, right? That's Foxtail's description, right, of what the Matham house is for. The house for unloved and unwanted objects that have nowhere else to go and you can't bear to throw away, right? Brombard extends his hand to receive the map, but then something catches his eye and he pauses. Perhaps I spoke too hastily. It appears that there is a claimant for this Matham after all, and he has run here at great speed to recover it. And there comes Bingo running up behind, and there he is, kneeling in the midst of the crowd, down there on one knee, panting, right? And I'm trying to target him in the middle of the crowd. There we go. All right.
I changed my mind.
I do not want that map to gather dust inside the Matham. He's rescuing the map from the Matham house, right? First impulse, put it away, right? I acknowledge that it's a curiosity. It's an interesting thing to look at. Let's put it in the Matham house so that other people can look at it if they want to. But nevertheless, the Matham house is a place to shove things aside. The Matham house contains things like it used to contain the mithril coat, right? Curiosities, maybe, but things that aren't really a part of hobbits' normal lives, right? Daily lives. And he decides, Bingo has made the decision, that he wants to learn more about the places it depicts. I want to wander the Weather Hills, walking stick in hand. I want to cross the last bridge and see what lies beyond. I want to see Rivendell. Are there really elves there? I will keep the map, Narnian, and I will use it to chart my adventure. Let us return to my hobbit hole and make some plans, my inspiring friend. Notice again, if you read carefully, not just read carefully the quest text, but read carefully Tolkien's books, you can see the references that are being made here. I want to wander the Weather Hills, walking stick in hand. His reference to the walking stick recalls chapter 1 of The Hobbit. Now, Bilbo Baggins used to go out walking a lot, and he would go out with a walking stick. The reference to the walking stick, for Bilbo in chapter 1, it's that when those Tookish thoughts, those dwarf-like thoughts, are stirring up within him, and he begins to imagine himself wearing a sword instead of a walking stick, right? So the walking stick was normal for Bilbo. Bingo doesn't even go walking, but like Bilbo used to do. Bilbo loved maps too, of course, you may remember, and had a map with his favorite walks marked in red hanging in his hallway. But he never imagined going out wearing a sword instead of a walking stick, right? And here's Bingo now imagining himself with a walking stick wandering the Weather Hills, right? So there he is, like, this is... Now, so notice, like Bilbo, he doesn't have any real sense of high adventure. Bilbo imagined having a sword, but he didn't imagine actually using the sword, right? And when the thought of real danger comes in, he faints dead away, right? When Thorin is giving his speech about how some of them may not return, he passes out, right? Bingo isn't even as gone as far as swords, right? He's for him, it's a step forward just to think about the walking stick, right? And to be finding these places on the map. But that's still a really big step for Bingo, right? The other reference, of course, is to the passage we were just looking at tonight. I want to see Rivendell. Are there really elves there, right? Like Sam and like Frodo, Bingo, too, seems to have been infected with stories of elves, right? He's curious about the wide world, and this curiosity has been inspired by this map, as he can see the physical sort of evidence of the stuff that is outside the map and beyond the... You know, most maps in the Shire, remember, we're told, only show white spaces beyond its borders, right? So here's a map with more than white spaces, and it makes him think. He also has heard stories about elves. Remember, even Ted Sandyman had heard stories about elves and dragons. The difference was Ted Sandyman didn't believe them, right? Sam is proud of believing them. But Bingo clearly believes them too, or at least wonders about them, right? And finds the idea of us going along with him to Rivendell to be inspiring, right? And that's pretty cool. So yes, Mariel says the adorable Bingo of the lamentable haircut. I agree, his hair is kind of funny looking. You have no idea where your feet will get swept off to. Exactly. He's so what we are seeing here, right, is yet another hobbit being swept off his feet onto the road. Here he is kneeling on the road, right, one of whose tributary went past his door. I love the way that they treat this. This quest line I actually find very typical, though actually more thoughtful than many, of how carefully they read the text. I've always been so impressed by the careful, close reading of Tolkien's text by the Lotro folks. They are excellent readers. They pay really close attention to all the words, and you can hear references to these different passages and lines popping in at various points. Bingo and the parallel that he is with Bilbo, he's not identical to Bilbo and in very different circumstances and with some different motivations, but the parallel between Bingo and Bilbo is a really interesting one that stretches out for quite some time as Bingo goes off on his journey. So, all right, we are running late. I was originally sort of hoping to get as far as to get a little further in Bingo's quest. He eventually goes off and learns how to swim, which is one of my favorite instances in the Bingo quest chain. Anyway, we're not going to be able to get there tonight. Great to see the Bingo Boffin, exhausted runner. I love his titles. Bingo being swept off his feet and beginning his adventure. Love how they treat that. Thank you, everybody, for joining me tonight. Maven, remind me, which server are we on next week?
We're on Crick Hollow next week.
Crick Hollow again next week. Great.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So we're gonna be on Crick Hollow next week, regular time, right? The evening time, not the early time. Yep. Crick Hollow next week. We'll look forward to joining you there. We're gonna be, as I said, moving on in chapter 3, definitely looking at the pursuit of the Black Riders and what we can learn about that. And so I look forward to talking about that. Thanks again to the Sons of Numenor for hosting us tonight and for the procession coming in and all your assistance here this evening. And I will look forward to catching up with everybody again next week. Don't forget, tomorrow night, Return of the Shadow class, we're going to be looking at the second draft of the Ancient History chapter of Chapter 2 of the Fellowship of the Ring. So that should be fun. We will be looking at that, the second draft of that, tomorrow night, and then Chapter 3 next week. Thanks very much, everybody. And oh, Mariel, I'm not 100% sure where the field trip is going to be, but it's not going to be a high-level field trip. You don't have to worry about that. I believe we'll be in the Shire next week. So, all right. Thanks very much, everybody. Good night now.